for an opening prayer and a salute to the flag. Mr. Cameron, if you would, please.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for all that you do for us. Lord, we just pray for your favor, your wisdom, and your direction for this city. And Lord, I just pray that you would look over us and provide us wisdom in everything that we do and everything that we say. And Lord, we just thank you for all that you do. Be with our family, be with this country, be with this nation. And we'll give you all the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Cameron. Oh, on the mayor's meetings and announcements, you have a card.
There's a card floating around.
I got a debt obligation.
No, I mean the card. We had a card.
Somebody gave you.
Is that what you're looking for?
Nope, not that one.
Well, happy birthday, Brandon. a card is forthcoming.
That's all right.
You know my card?
We recycle those.
Yeah.
And Mr. O'Donnell's birthday is on the 24th of November, so happy early birthday. Council, don't forget the budget meet. Is that it? Oh, not yet. Council, don't forget we do have the budget meeting on November 17th. And under Mayor's announcements again, we have good news. We're going to be swearing in a police officer, Trey Bridgewater. Chief Lott, if you would like to come up with Officer Bridgewater.
What time is this budget meeting?
Oh, good evening. And I'm going to try and do what I can to make this a regular thing for the police department. So when we bring somebody on, one, the council has an opportunity to see the new personnel that we bring on. I think it's a good way of affirming in front of the employees to swearing in a commitment to the community, a commitment to the council in doing their job. So I'm going to try and do this. It's very hard at times schedule-wise, but we were able to do this one. I'd like to introduce to you tonight our new police officer, our newest police officer, Trey Bridgewater, and his wife, Hannah. Come on up. Trey started with us actually just about a month ago, a little less, but October 19th. So it's taken me that long to get him here in the timing phase. But that's good. We've got him going operational. He is our 23rd of 25 slots that we have filled. So we still have two slots that we're working on filling. We were happy to bring him on. He's a Drury Police Academy graduate from last May, from May of 2016. And so we were able to grab him up. He's also an Army reservist, if I get it all right. So he's also serving our country in a different way. So what I'd like to do is do a ceremonial swearing in tonight. He's been sworn in by Brenda previously, but I'd like to do a swearing in ceremony, or ceremonial swearing in, if that's okay.
That's fine.
Okay. All right. So I want you to raise your right hand. Actually, let's come over here so we can get a picture. Come on here.
Stand right in the middle of
it. Okay. I state your name.
I, Trey Bridgewater.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I possess all the qualifications prescribed.
That I possess all the qualifications prescribed.
For my office by law.
For my office by law.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And of the State of Missouri.
And the State of Missouri.
The provisions of all laws of the state.
The provisions of all laws in the state.
Affecting cities of this class.
Affecting cities of this class.
And the ordinances of the City of Republic.
And the ordinances of the City of Republic.
And that I will faithfully demean myself in office.
And that I will faithfully demean myself in office.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Alright, so normally I have an important person in the officer's life pin them. I think it's symbolic, and I think it's something that's important in their lives, too. So, Hannah, be nice. I just gave her instructions. Look at that. Woo!
Congratulations.
He's not working tonight, but he's, you're in phase one of our field training program, right?
Phase two.
Oh, phase two.
I do your phase two.
He's on phase two, so we're doing good. We're happy to have him on board.
Yes.
And we look forward to a lot that he can bring to the city. So thank you for taking the time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Brandon, again, happy birthday. The wayward card found its way home.
Thank you.
We do not have a public hearing tonight. I'd like to open to citizen participation. Anyone wanting to speak about anything not on the agenda, please step forward and give us your best 3 minutes. Anything not on the agenda. 3 minutes. Seeing none, citizen participation closed. A motion and a second for the approval of the consent agenda.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. On to the financial report. Welcome, John O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And good evening, everyone. We got the financials out today. My apologies for getting out later than usual. Obviously, the budget was taking up quite a bit of our time. As you can see from the revenue and expense report, we are ahead. First off, let me explain something else. We have simplified the report format, taking out superfluous lines and getting down to what our revenues and expenditures on a cash basis for both October of 16 and October of 15. We have revenues are exceeding what we've done this time last year. Obviously, expenditures are much greater due to the fact that we have a number of expenditures of first-time nature. Last month, we discussed some of those, such as the City Hall land purchase and so forth. Some other expenditures of note was the $125,000 to Greene County as part of an intergovernmental agreement on street improvements. Additional now up to $25,000 year to date with respect to the city administrator search, and $29,000 in streets regarding purchase of an F-250. Also, Heinz Oakwood, this is the first year that we have started that project. And so we have $196,000 in engineering costs that are also reflected in the 2016 numbers. With respect to the general fund, as we talked about in the budget workshop, we will have an administrative transfer that will take place in December for the 2016 budget. That transfer, which will be revenue to the general fund and expense to the other funds, is in the neighborhood of $759,000, and that will shore up our general fund position. And I believe that's all I have for right now. I will entertain any questions that you have.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. O'Donnell. Any questions for our finance director? Any questions at all? I would like to thank you and all the staff. You all look tired. I don't know why. I mean, it was a superman, I guess. No, you guys look tired. You guys for getting all the stuff done on the budget. We appreciate that. Appreciate the hard work. That's all staff, okay? I really appreciate that. And we do have, I don't want you to forget, we do have the budget meeting on the 17th at 5:30, and it will be held here in City Hall.
Yes.
Council members, please attend, and the public is also welcome to attend that also. It will be televised, but you're more than welcome. The public is more than welcome to attend. Any questions for Mr. O'Donnell on the financial report? Seeing none, I need a motion and a second for the approval of the financial report.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. Thank you, Mr. O'Donnell.
Thank you.
On reports from staff, Mr. Cameron.
The only thing I have to report again is just the budget meeting, like you said, is Thursday at 5:30. One thing that we will also do that I did not reiterate is probably 2 weeks from tonight will be the first reading of the budget. There will be a workshop at 5:30 on that night, just if there's any additional questions regarding the budget discussion. It's also important to note that I did not note in the work session was that it's an opportunity to sit down with staff, the leadership of all the city, to get a chance to look at the budget numbers, to give them a perspective of exactly where the city's financial position is as well, to get a better understanding of things, of the debt obligations, and to understand how the city's financials are set up, because I believe when a lot of people look at the financials, it looks like all the restricted cash accounts, you would think that's how much money is available to spend for raises or to buy equipment. Those things are restricted cash, and so I look forward to talking about that and just working with staff to go over the things that are going on. So we'll do that, and then, like I said, 2 weeks from tonight will be the first reading, and then I guess a month from now we'll do the second reading. So thank you.
Very good. Is that all?
That's it.
Mr. Derrickson?
No, sir.
Not a thing. On the future community event, Mr. Keeling.
Good evening. Future community events for the remainder of November. This coming Thursday, Senior Movie Day, 3 p.m. at the Republic Community Center. I also wanted to note one thing that wasn't on here. This coming Friday is a makeup of Star Wars The Force Awakens. Originally, this was held at the AMP. We had some technical issues. It's going to be made up at the Community Center this Friday starting at 7 p.m. Have a meet and greet with Darth Vader if you're interested.
Ooh.
Good stuff. November 18th through December 2nd is Todd Academy. That's from ages 2 to 5. It's at 9:30 or 10:45 on Friday. November 18th is the last day to register for youth boys basketball. That's for both K through 6th grade and for peewee hoops for 4 and 5-year-olds. That season begins right after the new year. November 19th, this coming Saturday, is the Kiwanis Christmas Parade. That begins at 10 a.m.
Who is the Grand Marshal this year at the Christmas Parade?
I think some of us know the answer to that question. It's Mr. Cameron there to your immediate left.
Somebody told me that it was David Cameron.
Prime Minister is going to be there. Pretty big deal.
We'll pray for you.
Sorry, Jared. Sorry to interrupt you.
No. I do want to say the Kiwanis does a great job with the parade. It's really good year after year, so I haven't looked at the weather forecast. Hopefully, it'll cooperate for them. So. November 21st, which is next Monday, early bird season passes go on sale for the Republic Aquatic Center. Those are discounted season passes available just for the holiday season for 2017 season. November 21st and 28th, those are Mondays, is Toddler Open Gym at 9 a.m. That's held at the Republic Activities Building. Next week, November 24th and 25th, in observance of Thanksgiving holiday, city offices will be closed that Thursday and Friday. November 28th, registration begins for girls' youth volleyball. That's for grades 3 through 8. And finally, November 30th is a deadline for Republic Veterans Memorial bricks. Those are honorary or memorial bricks to be placed in the memorial in the spring of next year.
Thank you, Mr. Keeling. I do want to thank the Republic Parks Department for the Boogie Bash celebration. It was, how many people, do you have any idea how many people were there?
Had our, by far our biggest one. We thought in and out through the night maybe around 1,000. Really well-attended event. I appreciate all the volunteers we had out there, including yourself. I thought it really went well that night.
It was a huge success.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
On the Board Commission and Committee schedule, Board of Adjustments, December 3rd. Capital Improvements Committee, November 23rd. City Council Budget Workshop, November 17th. And that is with the budget reading. City Council meeting, November 28th, and we will have a workshop on that date also. Is that correct?
That is correct.
City Council meeting on December 12th. Planning and Zoning Commission, November 21st. We have no old business or tabled items, so we're on to new business. I need a motion and a second for the first reading of Bill Number 16-21.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, amending various sections of the city's personnel policy.
Thank you, Brenda. And Ms. Addington.
Good evening.
Is this
Thank
your
you.
First address of council?
It is.
Lots of questions, Kathy. Lots of questions.
Good evening. The request is to change four areas of immediate concern within the personnel policy. Section 2.6 will allow for more efficiency in filling of vacancies by adding the and designee. Section 4.4B is striking the July 1st reference to annual evaluations, basing those annual evaluations on hire date, promotion date, or last increment date instead. This will allow consistency throughout the city. The reference to sick leave, there's an inconsistency as currently written. This will allow for language cleanup and consistency applied to when sick leave usage may be used. And 11.7, changing the proration of personal time off This is in compliance with FLSA for our exempt employees.
Very good. Any questions for Ms. Annington? I'm going to give her a hard time. It's her first time. Mr. Jones.
Let's at least throw one at her. in section, the number two there, 4.4B,
uh-huh.
Talking about performance appraisals. How are they, not done on the seniority date at this point, or how are they appraised?
Currently, it's July 1.
Okay.
So, as you can imagine, we have employees, not all employees start July 1. So there are some that are not quite here a year, and there are others that are here more than a year before they're getting an evaluation. So by having it on their hire date, promotional date, or last increment date, that'll allow for an exact 1 year of evaluation.
So is that verbiage going to be placed in there saying that they will be done? Okay, it is based upon that. That's in
correct.
The, okay, good.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. Any other questions for Ms. Addington?
Yes, sir.
One point that I might add to that is that it's very difficult when you have all the appraisals done at one time. I mean, it seems like if you could do them incrementally throughout the year, you'd have, rather than just trying to get a whole bunch done at one time, it adds a little bit more to it. But I've also asked Ms. Addington to change, to bring you a revision of the employee handbook in general. We just wanted to address the overall, the immediate changes right now, but I do foresee in 2017 one of the biggest changes is a rewrite of the entire employee handbook that will remove and clean up a lot of different discrepancies that we have, but these were the most immediate ones that need to be addressed, so I appreciate her work so far.
Does this have any correlation to merit increases, or does that happen once a year, does that happen during the evaluation period?
It happens in July, as my understanding is.
Merit increases are tied to evaluation.
So they could potentially have their evaluation, but they wouldn't see that increase until July 1st. Is that?
No, the COLA would still be effective in July. The step increase would now be aligned with their evaluation.
Okay, so it's not aligned. Okay, separate thing. I'm trying to get that straight in my head. Thank you.
And David Cameron brought up a good point about the getting the evaluations. And have you talked to staff? Do you have any input from staff on this?
I have not. I've just gotten input from some of the department heads.
Okay.
That'll be the next step, is to communicate that.
Okay.
To be honest with you, I think it'll allow for more consistency, so I expect a positive response.
Okay. All right. Any other questions for Ms. Addington? This is the first read, so if you do have any questions, please direct them to Ms. Addington. Thank you very much. Lost my place. I need a motion second for the first reading of Bill Number 16-22.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? And that motion carries.
An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, authorizing the City Administrator to execute a municipal and cost apportionment agreement with the Missouri Highway and Transportation Commission and the Republic R3 School District for street improvements to the intersection of Republic Road, State Route M, and Repmo Drive.
Thank you, Brenda. Mr. Brock.
Thank you, Mayor. Council Member Call, back in August, we asked for permission to submit an application to the cost share program with MoDOT, with the school system as our partner. Our project was selected for funding. The school district is pleased with the results. They're ready to move ahead. Agenda item tonight is the formal cost share agreement to be co-signed by the Republic School District and Missouri Highway Transportation Commission, MoDOT. I do want to point out that the funding formula has changed just a bit from the grant application that we submitted. Original estimate, our out of cash expense was expected to be about $100,000, the same with the school. Now the school intend to donate a significant amount of right-of-way. The proposed improvement is a roundabout. They have a much bigger footprint than a signal. And so the alignment of that roundabout will be shifted south a bit. onto the school property. So the funding formula was adjusted to take into account their donation of that property, estimated to be a little over $35,000. And it did not have a straightforward effect on the funding formula because that expense has to be taken off the top, so to speak. It's not treated the same as cash. So the net effect, our cash contribution needed to increase by about $14,120. However, the surface transportation funds, the federal highway funds that we receive, that reduced by over $28,000. And that's a good thing for us. Those STP funds, we currently have those obligated through 2019 on the Hines and Oakwood, and we were going to be barely eking by to obligate enough funds for this program. So overall, the city's total expense went down, and the benefit that we got with the school land donation is it chipped away at our STP fund a little more than to offset the cash increase. This is a project that MoDOT is wanting to move forward on rather quickly. They've asked to set aside some time to go ahead and start looking at potential consultants for the job. I do know MoDOT is the lead agency. We will be participating in the consultant selection and through the design process. But would expect this to be something that could go to construction as early as late next year. One other feature I do want to point out, the ordinance reads that the agreement will be substantially in the form and content as that attached. There is one item that is being negotiated, and there are a number of these cost share programs that are in the works across Southwest Missouri, but the communities, including us, are asking for a little more input into potential cost overruns. You'll notice that is a feature of the agreement. If there is a cost overrun, Republic will bear the cost of that. So language that we're trying to get in these agreements essentially says that they will consult and confer with the local entities before they approve any cost overruns, before they authorize any change orders which would increase the cost of the project. Now, I don't expect that to be an issue. Along as we developed this project, we tried to err on the high side of the estimation, so we do believe overall the project cost will come under, but I do want to point out that there may be one slight revision if we're successful before this is finally adopted.
Thank you, Mr. Brock, and this will be a big safety improvement out there at the high school. I know we've talked to links with the school and MoDOT, and they're all in agreement on the roundabout. Is that your...
Well, I think that there's going to be a roundabout out there. I wouldn't say that it was that everyone agreed, but I do think we had a very healthy conversation with MoDOT, talking with their engineers at OTO, and I think they made some concessions or even some provisions in there in that discussion that offered a, if I recall in the design, if you're heading eastbound, there's a ramp that you can go to avoid the roundabout. They're building a bigger footprint that would allow for an easier expansion, so if it needed to go to two lanes. But all that is being considered in the original discussion and landscape. And they also allowed us to increase an increased traffic count or evaluate the traffic count as a part of it. So I didn't see it just someone saying it was all or nothing, but they did have proper justification with a lot of their engineers that were not present at the council meeting whenever they discussed the roundabout. But they did have four or five different engineers to explain how they arrived at that justification. And after that meeting, while I mean, I still have my own personal opinion about a roundabout, that's not what plays a part versus what everybody else. The studies do demonstrate that, from their perspective, if we're going to get anything done at that intersection versus signalization or anything, it was going to be a roundabout because of all the other demands and requests that met warrants for signalization in other parts of the state. So it's got to meet warrants to get signalization.
But do we know how far off we were?
We weren't even close.
Not even close?
No. And the thing about, and what's difficult about that discussion is, if you look at all the commercial property that surrounds that site and say, and even what was discussed, because Mr. Wistrom was with us in the meeting, was with a stadium sitting there and having additional traffic counts, what's that going to do? They do not anticipate, they do not even allow for that even, I mean, you just to forecast and say, there's going to be growth in that area, look at all the commercial, that is not allowed.
And they have to have hard studies.
But remind me, if we do this, we tie up that money for how long?
5 years.
So we can't do anything else for 5 years.
Yeah. Or, but let me back up though. If they change that and say all of a sudden the warrants all of a sudden say, hey, you need a two-lane, the footprint, the subgrade, all the build, if I'm correct,
yes.
The subgrade for a two-lane roundabout, which is substantial, has already been put in place. So they're building for a one lane, but the subgrade everything underneath it will be built for a two lane, so they would just rip out the concrete. The majority of the dirt work, easement acquisition, in my opinion, would be done on the front end, and then you got some concrete amendments 5 years later. So I don't believe that it's an all loss.
I'm all about safety. However, when you're talking about a major, that's one of the entryways into Republic, and if you sit out there at 5 to 5:30, and you're coming over that hill, and you've got a roundabout. My thing isn't so much in the morning as it is at 5 o'clock.
Sure.
And popping over that hill.
Yeah, this is...
And so what? It's going to put pressure on 60 if it's slowing down traffic. But I don't know. I mean, again, did we lower the speed limit down there?
Not yet.
May I address that?
Yes, sir.
They did a speed study. I mean, we started in 2010. There was a couple of serious injury accidents out there. That's when we started meeting with MoDOT. And one of the first things they did turning movement counts of both entrances to the school. They did speed studies. Those early results came back, and essentially, according to their engineering guide, did not warrant a potential reduction. And the relationship with the city and MoDOT on speed limits, they put up the signs, we enact the ordinances, and do the enforcement. We really don't have a mechanism to require speed limit adjustment one way or the other. So that was something that was looked at. Now, they do acknowledge that is desired, a reduction in the speeds around those entrances, and that's one of the features that they attribute to a roundabout, is it will, you have a design speed of about 25 to 30 miles an hour to maneuver through that roundabout. So they see that as an advantage to lower the speed. If you're a commuter and you're interested in getting home to at the end of the day, maybe a little bit of a conflict there. But as Mr. Cameron said, two things were very apparent. One, if we wanted to participate in the program, we didn't meet warrants, the intersection improvements would have to be limited to a roundabout. But they were willing to look at growth and expansion for the future, and I think that's a plus for us.
Mr. Mayor,
yes.
One other note is, with all that being said, mm-hmm. with the additional right-of-way and the subgrade being done, at any time, say all of a sudden the traffic signal is, it meets warrants. It's not like the subgrade and the things that are there cannot be modified eventually. I mean, I'm not engineering it in my mind, but it can be adjusted long term. But I think that to slow down traffic to 15 to 20 miles an hour, that's the only way it was going to happen.
Correct me if I'm wrong. You said that we're going to have more right of way for the school, so it's actually not going to. It's going to come more towards the school.
Well, a slight adjustment. But as Mr. Cameron noted, if you're going eastbound, there'll be a free ride into the school, so that's a separate lane that enters into the school. If you're coming exiting the school and you want to head east, there'll be a free ride, a dedicated lane to make that right turn lane. So,
what about coming from east to west?
Then you do a
three-quarter
maneuver
okay.
through.
Okay.
But everyone recognizes the value of property. So, it's a combination of the center line of that roundabout shifting south a little bit, and those additional lanes the majority of the land will come from the school.
Well, and the reason that I'm just bringing up for discussion is you got to imagine 5 o'clock, daylight savings, I'm heading westbound, I'm popping over a hill, sun's here, all of a sudden I got traffic backed up. I mean, I know that, you know, safety is a major concern for kids, but it's also a safety for people getting home to their kids. And I'm not, again, not saying that I'm against it, just my thought is when you come over that hill, there could be a potential with the sun in your eyes and a slower speed.
Well, and that's gonna exist with the signal or roundabout. But I'm not. Where's the city limit line there?
It goes on. It goes out.
Farm Road 107.
It says Farm Road 107 and Republic Road.
Can't
set
the limit
there.
Quarter mile.
200 yards, maybe.
No, state highway. We can't set the limit on that.
No.
We can petition it. We can continue to ask for it. More signage, something flattened today, a roundabout ahead, something try to help draw attention to the fact that it's there.
So a scenario like Brandon describes, it'll take a serious accident to get.
Well, I think that's why they put a roundabout in. They're just,
well, I know, but the roundabout creates a potential for that traffic backed up, pop over the hill, you have an instant rear ending.
Yeah.
I mean, that this is an opportunity to hedge that, the chances of that happening.
It's all based on the design.
Yeah. And to me, you also said that this was a late next year.
It seems
like a logical summer job for me, because the school's got to shut down that entrance. They'll have one way in and one way out.
That's not ideal for the.
Well, that's horrible.
Chief, did you have something to add?
I just wanted to add there's the coming westbound, the comment by the councilman. That's what it is, exists as today, because of if there's left turns going into the school, causes the same slowdown. This is a dilemma between slowing traffic and keeping that an expeditious route for people to come to and from home. And, I mean, obviously a signal would be fantastic, but that's not where we're at with the warrant situation. This is the next best thing in terms of slowing the traffic down through that intersection. I'm certain that it will require some advance notification on the other side of the hill that you're about to enter a roundabout with the lower speed limit so that traffic will slow. I can't imagine you're going to have vehicles traveling 75 miles an hour over the top of that hill and come with cars. There will be plenty of notice in the morning.
And the roundabout that I've seen, you'll have the roundabout sign posted. I don't know what MoDOT's stipulation is on that, but I'm sure it'll be posted, and Ron Derrickson brings up a good point. We'll have that situation with the light anyway. So the situation with light or roundabout or the situation now, it's going to be the same. So this is just going to help move traffic, I think, a lot freer than backing up with light. And I guess that's what MoDOT's looking at. So
MoDOT's looked at that decline, I guess. It's not a hill, really. It's a coming westbound. It's a drop-off. They looked at that when we talked about a signal, and it's their position from an engineering standard is that it's not significant in terms of difficult for vehicles to see either coming out from Republic Road or Road 103, that it's plenty of distance for vehicles to slow or do whatever's necessary for the
And my thing is it like you said, is it a dramatic change from what we've got? Because we're tying up funds for 5 years, and having a discussion over funds that we're tying up, now we don't have access till 2021. I mean, I'm just throwing it out there that we can't do that with anything else. We do this 5 years. That's it.
I have a separate question around the consultant. You said that if Republic's taking a back seat, MoDOT's driving, right?
Correct. They're a lead agency.
So it says in here that you said that if there are overruns that they'll confer with the city. What kind of control mechanisms do you have? Because I think it says in here that 80% is UTP and 20% is cash, which I take it is what, general fund?
No, this would be would have to be transportation funds.
Okay. So I guess my question is, what kind of input will you have in the planning and protection against overruns?
As it stands today, council member, it's the language in the agreement and this the cooperation of the folks with MoDOT. And that was the reason for my comment. There's a drive amongst the different jurisdictions that are entering these agreements to get some language in there to allow the city to have more formal oversight if there's a change order or a cost overrun come up, to have more authority to say yay or nay.
I don't know what kind of scope creep you can see on these projects.
We will have the letter of the agreement, we will get those updates as the project is designed. Here's the project estimate. When the bids come in, we'll be able to know where we stand against our original funding formula. But we do desire to have a little more formal leeway in making those project decisions.
Okay. That's kind of where I was. That's what I wanted to know.
That seems dangerous.
It's risky.
It does seem really dangerous.
3% over on 60 grand that we own all of a sudden.
Our experience.
If we don't have the cash to pay it, then yeah.
Our recent experience was a cost share between MoDOT and Republic to build the intersection in front of Highway 60. We were not privy to the decisions, but our overall cost came in probably 10% under the original estimates. And Don Seiko was the project engineer from MoDOT on that project. Don Seiko is the project engineer on this project, and always found them to be very forthright. Not to say there weren't issues that came up during construction and had to be addressed, and we had some change orders, but we had change orders that added cost. We had change orders that reduced the cost. The net experience was a good one, and cost the city less than was originally spelled out in that cost share agreement.
What do other cities do in this type of situation? Do they have the same language? Do they mean it's normal? Because I can appreciate that he's the project manager for this, but I mean, that still doesn't make me question this any less.
Well, it is, and I mean every city that's going to participate has the exact same agreement, and if there's a change that allows cities to participate in a more integrated fashion, then every agreement will be amended in the same fashion.
Okay.
So. If we say no, can we apply for those funds again next year?
No. No, this was really a one-time thing. This was a result of, I don't want to say found money, but MoDOT had essentially $13 million that they had not expected to have for the Oto region, Ozark Transportation region. And Oto put together this program. Came to Oto, said, how do you want us to spend $13,000? The members of OTO met and came up, well, why don't you put together this intersection improvement program, cost share program? So it really is a one-time issue. If you watch state legislature, you know that state funding formula for transportation is not in a good shape, so I would not expect cost share program to come back for many, many years. They had a formal cost share program that they canceled in 07, I think it was, and that was recurring on an annual basis. I do not expect to see that return anytime soon.
Do you personally think that this roundabout, and I want to emphasize, dramatically change what we have right now as far as the accidents, traffic flow? Will it dramatically change?
I think it will dramatically change. And that's the number one issue that we're trying to address, all those accidents. The worst accidents happen when you have cars at very different speeds. A car sitting still and a car traveling at 55 is a very bad situation. And that's what we have out there without dedicated left turn lanes. So I think it'll dramatically change that aspect of it. It will dramatically change people's experience driving absolutely. If you're traveling home, this is going to be something new that you're going to have to get used to, and there will be a break-in period where people come to have need to expect that that's coming up over the hill or around the corner.
Good question. This is a first read. I would highly recommend driving out of the area, look at the area. Is there, they probably don't have a conceptualization now. Is there any possible way we could get one? Or would that be?
We had one to look at our, when we met with MoDOT. I've asked to have that sent to us. I'll hit them up again on that and try to have that available for council next meeting.
If we could have that for council next meeting or even in the interim so council can see that, that would be greatly appreciated. Again, this is a first read. Do you have any other questions for Mr. Brock?
Not a question, but in Lebanon, they've built a new school. And on the east west side of that school, they built a roundabout coming out of it and maybe a block. Two blocks, there's another roundabout that you have to go through. That's on the first Lebanon exit on the south side. So they've got them there at that school.
Okay. Might not hurt them.
Well, Mr. Mayor, they did reference Joplin in the meeting. Was if anybody wanted to see what one in a high traffic volume area at a high speed to see how it functions. To look at that. That was another one they referenced in the meeting, was that they actually had one.
That's a two lane.
They said if you wanted a visual to want to look at, I've not gone through that one, so I couldn't really speak to it. I just know we expressed the concern that I'd prefer, you know, what if we bought the light? You know, what if the city paid for it? The state maintains them. They don't have a budget for it, they don't just throw it as an excuse, but. It wasn't like we went there and just said we rolled over and said, hey, listen, we'll just take whatever you can give. We tried to throw out putting in a traffic signal, and what if we paid for the signal? But somebody's got to maintain it because it's on a state highway, and it just wasn't going to get the warrants, and it wasn't there. And that's kind of where it arrived to. And so they gave us all the justifications. If you go back to your admin report, there's about 7 bullet points I provided you with that. It outlines it, kind of where we're at today. And so... that's what I encourage you. We can send that stuff out, but I thought that design was also sent out or provided as well. It showed the merge lane at the very next meeting.
All right. Any other questions for Mr. Brock? If you have any questions, please direct those to Mr. Brock over the next couple of weeks. And again, I encourage you to go out in the area, look at the area, and get an overview of that. I need a motion and a second for the first reading of Bill Number 16-23.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, amending certain sections of Chapters 205, 412, 340, 405, 410, 415, 420, 425, 435, 500, 510, 520, 605, 705, and 710 of the Republic City Code as a housekeeping matter with regard to a department name change from the Planning and Development Department to the name Community Development Department by amending those sections as set forth in Exhibit A.
Thank you, Brenda. Which department is your name?
Can you repeat that?
As stated in the exhibit, this is basically a housekeeping matter with a recent change in the name from Planning and Development Department to Community Development Department. There were some sections in the, or several obvious sections in the code that needed to have just that amount of change made. And in a couple of places, you'll also notice that we changed from the planning department being responsible for something to the public works director being responsible for it instead of the city planner. And that is something we've been looking at doing for several years with the change in the name to the department. It made sense to go ahead and just cover everything that needed to be changed. And so that Exhibit A that's attached to the ordinance sets out the sections and the subparagraph numbers of what where the changes are to be made.
Thank you, Mr. Derrickson. Any questions for Mr. Derrickson? questions? And this is a first read, so please look through this. If you have any questions, please direct those to Mr. Derrickson. I need a motion second for the first reading of Bill number 16-24.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, amending Chapter 215, Republic City Code, Offenses, Article 4, Offenses Concerning Public Peace, Section 215.300, Weapons Carrying Concealed, Other Unlawful Use, by amending Paragraph H, Subparagraph 3, to extend the sunset date for hunting in certain agricultural areas of the city.
Thank you, Brenda. Mr. Derrickson again.
This comes from the consolidation with the Village of Brookline. One of the things that was placed in the agreement between the City of Republic and the Village of Brookline at the time that the consolidation was taking place was that hunting would continue to be allowed as long as it didn't create any major problems. The way council has addressed that for the last several years is through this paragraph H, which defines a geographic area, and then just to monitor development in that geographic area, we have been using sunset provisions every 2 or 3 years, having council review that to determine if either this exception needs to be eliminated or the geographic area needs to be adjusted because of development that's taking place in that area. And so the recommendation is to extend the sunset for 2 years, and I don't believe anyone on staff raised any issues with the geographic area at this point.
Thanks, Mr. Derrickson. Any questions or concerns for Mr. Derrickson?
With the development out there, how far away from that is the development?
Do you, Garrett, do you have a map or anything on that showing this area?
I didn't bring a map back in for next time, just so you can see the areas where it's lawful to do this. I did look at the map when Ron sent this out, and I didn't have any concerns. The development hasn't expanded since the last time we approved this in such a way that I felt like anything is going to be at risk. Given the other provisions that are in here about how you can't pass on or through a property so close to the structure. So if development were to occur in an area that we just weren't anticipating, there would be those additional protections if structures are built. But I'll bring a map and I can supply that at the next meeting or before by email so that everybody can sort of visualize where this will be.
I don't think there's been any major developments except in that industrial park, which was not a part of this since the last time it was renewed.
The one big development that I'd see be concerned would be that city park out there. That would be a major development out there. It would be detrimental to this that we've not had any calls.
Perhaps I didn't try to develop it, no calls.
Okay. All right. Any other questions for Mr. Derrickson or any staff? And this is a first read. If you do have any questions, please notify Mr. Derrickson. Contact him. I need a motion second for the first reading of Bill number 16-25.
Motion.
Second. I have that motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? The motion carries.
An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, approving the final plat of the Woodland Park Estate Phase 3 subdivision located along the 1400 block of South Illinois Avenue in the City of Republic, Missouri.
Thank you, Brenda. Mr. Tyson.
Thank you. Approving this final plat will allow the developer to create these 26 single-family residential lots and allow the developer to begin pulling building permits to build homes on them. All 26 of these lots are located within our medium-density single-family residential zoning district, which means that at minimum they are at least 9,000 square feet in order to control density of development here. This is the final phase of the Woodland Park Estates development. There are two
existing phases in this development, I anticipate will be in the same character as those existing phases. Staff is recommending approval of this final plat. There is one issue outstanding with the developer. They have yet to provide to the city their maintenance bond for public improvements within this. They have committed, and their bank has committed, that they will have that prior to the second reading of this ordinance. If it turns out that they are not able to provide that, then we will recommend to council to table this.
Thank you, Mr. Tyson. Any questions on this particular item for Mr. Tyson? Yeah, this is one of the things that council looks at quite a bit, is the approval of final planning. So, any questions, Mr. Self?
Any covenants or anything out there that we know of that will?
No, sir.
Okay.
And that's true for the other two phases as well.
Yeah, I didn't know if it starts with one phase, the all three phases have to be the same. Or can that be?
Not necessarily. You could, you would not have to include all three phases, but it's my understanding
usually
that the developer doesn't have any intent to do that.
Thank you. Any other questions for Mr. Tyson while he's up here? Yes, Mr. Campbell.
Just a quick question. Being new, what is the average size square footage of a home in these, in this area now?
I don't have a number for you. I think there are 14 existing homes in the first two phases. My best guess would be between 15 and 1,700 square feet.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Tyson? Again, this is a first read. If you do have any questions, please contact Mr. Tyson. And again, backing up to a little bit, Garrett, the map, if you can provide that map for council for the agricultural area.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. I need a motion and second for the first reading of bill number 16-26.
Motion. Second.
I have motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, authorizing the City Administrator to execute a Traffic Engineering Assistance Program Agreement with the Missouri Highway and Transportation Commission.
Thank you, Brenda. Mr. Brock.
Thank you, Mayor. This is another agreement with the Missouri Highway and Transportation Committee, and it has to do with their Traffic Engineering Assistance Program. This is an annual competitive grant that they solicit applications for. We applied for that this summer and were selected for funding to look at the intersection of Lynn and Hines. That's a high accident intersection, the highest one of surface streets here in Republic. They're generally minor accidents, not very serious injuries, but the numbers are up there. We get a lot of complaints in our offices. I don't know, Chief, if you do as well. So we put together an application that we thought would be successful, and that's particular here when we get down to some of the bullet points. The funding is 80-20. Would be funded up to $8,000. City share would be $2,000. So the elements that we've got set up to look at would be to go back and look at a traffic signal warrant analysis. You may recall we did one in 2013 with the Transportation Master Plan at that time. We were not close to a signal analysis, but the recommendation was to come back and on a recurring basis check those numbers again, so we've got that element. We would look at alternative traffic control methods, and this is where we scored a couple extra points in our application. It would include a two-way, four-way, and roundabout. I don't want to get too hung up on roundabouts on this issue, but it did probably, I don't know if it kicked us over the line for funding or not, but we'll have to spend a little bit of time considering it that. But here's where we get into, I think, the interesting part is, one would be a future traffic capacity analysis. If we don't have the warrants for a traffic signal today, when are we going to get there? Is it going to be 2 years from now or 4 years from now? What we've done before really just told us a snapshot in time. Well, no, you're not there. We need to have a better idea of when those traffic levels are going to meet that that level. And then also, and this was actually a suggestion from a former council member, would be to look at constructing another access into that commercial district. A lot of these accidents are people on Lynn Avenue. They're either crossing Hine Street or trying to make a turning movement off of Lynn Avenue. A lot of that traffic comes from the east side of town. So if we can intercept that and divert that traffic in through a second entrance, then we've eliminated some of those turning movements. So those are the primary bullet points, or the primary components of the traffic study that we've got set up. This should move along fairly quickly if approved, and the results back to the City Council in late spring of 2017.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Brock. Yeah, we've talked a couple times about this traffic warrant signal or traffic signal warrant analysis. Is there any way we can get numbers from MoDOT on what they say is go, no-go on that?
Absolutely.
If we can get that to council, I would appreciate that way. Give us all a heads up on what we're looking at. And also, if we do it, do you have access to the traffic council we've had in the past, like the early one at 2013 at that stop?
Yes.
At that area? Uh-huh. And also the one out there on the highway. If we can have access to those two, that would be appreciated.
And also post it on our Facebook to tell everybody to drive over those little black cables about 20 or 30 extra times a day.
Back and forth, just back and forth.
Just.
Any questions for Mr. Brock?
The Hines and Oakwood project, I assume, that widening that's going on is still on target, right?
We are still moving forward, yes.
Does that have any impact on this? Does the widening go up?
It does not. Our project starts about at Pinewood, which is probably 800 or 1,000 feet away.
I'm just wondering, because that would definitely impact the traffic there. So, take my question. You answered it. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Mendez. Mr. Self, did you have anything?
No. So who would do the engineering again?
We will select the engineer that does the study.
Okay.
That would be the first thing that comes back to City Council, would be an agreement with the particular firm that we think is best to do the work.
David, I was on council back when we had Lynn Street widening and so forth. Was anything done at that time with that intersection? Or looking forward to a light?
There were conduits placed under the roadway, and so I don't know necessarily the value of that nowadays with directional boring. It's those aren't too expensive to reproduce, but I do know that they tried to anticipate improvements at that time. One of the other elements here, didn't maybe hit the highlights, we want to look at pedestrian count, see how many pedestrians we have traveling through that intersection, and look at if we are going to build a signal, the complications or maybe how things may have gotten better if we were to tie in the timing with the signal at Hines and 60. That's always been mentioned as a major reason why we don't want to have a traffic signal there, but I think with the new programming that MoDOT uses, that situation should have changed by now.
Thank you, Mr. Rock. Thank you, Mr. Shears. Any other questions for Mr. Rock while we have him here? And this is a first reading. If you do have any questions, please direct those to Mr. Rock and Mr. Cameron. He'd be more than happy to answer them. Thank you, Mr. Brock. We're in the home stretch, folks. That is it for new business. On to other business. Resolution number 16-R-85, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, authorizing the execution of an advanced funding agreement with the Ozarks Transportation Organization. I need a motion and a second.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Mr. Brock.
Thank you, Mayor. This is a companion bill to the cost share we spoke of just a few minutes ago. In order to secure the surface transportation funds for that project, we have to get approval through the Ozarks Transportation Organization. So this very brief agreement essentially allows the city to draw a future federal obligation, future federal funds that would be normally directed to Republic anyway. As council member mentioned, this is borrowing out into the future. Our current Hines and Oakwood project, We're utilizing those federal funds through fiscal year 2019. The Repmo Drive and Republic Road intersection then would obligate funds 2020 through 2022. So this is an approach that OTO encourages, particularly for smaller communities like Republic, where our annual appropriation is typically about $320-$330. So these advanced funding arrangements allows you to participate in larger projects. Seems like nothing's cheap anymore, but this is a necessary part to go along with the cost share arrangement. We do need to have this both items approved for that project to go forward.
Thank you, Mr. Brock. Any questions for Mr. Brock on this resolution? Excuse me.
So if we say yes to, like, if I say yes, that means that, like, we're could I say no later as far as?
Yes, if the cost share agreement is not approved, then
But we can agree to this, but then for the second read,
you're not required to use the funds if you get approved for.
Absolutely. We could. There's a they're in section number 2 in the now. Therefore, it references the specific TIP project. So this agreement only applies to the cost share. If that particular project doesn't go forward, this agreement could not be held to a separate project.
Did that answer your question?
I think so.
Yeah. Did you have anything to add to that? You're waving your pen.
Well, I mean, I think the comment, even from the very first night when we heard about it, is just difficult that you tie up your funds.
Right. So that's what I'm saying, is if we do this, are we tying up funds? Can I say yes to this and no later?
You say yes to this and vote no at the second reading of the agreement, the ordinance, I believe, at the next meeting on the, and it kills the project.
This doesn't create any liability.
Right.
Correct.
This is
correct. Only if the other agreement is approved.
I think it's important, though, when you engage the school district in the same conversation about where they're at and what is needed, and having all those at the table and trying to dialogue what is the best interest moving forward. I think that's why. I would encourage everyone to talk to the school district, too, about it. I mean, if you get a chance to say, hey, where do they stand on that particular project, and will it help their cause as well? And so I think that's what's difficult, though, is, as I said the very first night, whenever MoDOT was at our meeting, it's very difficult to know what all the different needs are. And in 5 years from now, all it's going to take is that stadium project. We could, hypotheticals or what ifs, as much as we sit there and discuss it that day, just do not get to play in there, because I believe that area is just going to take off once the stadium goes up. Commercial's going to go, and then by the time we're down, we're going to be taking it out.
Same question could be, what would happen in 5 years if we don't have this project? Can we sustain the stadium with our current road structure? Would we have more access?
I'm sorry, say it again.
So if we didn't do the roundabout project, what would be the situation 5 years from now or 3 years from now?
That's why I asked if it makes a dramatic change from what we...
We just want to make sure it's the right move. I get it.
I agree wholeheartedly. I think once it's been a two-lane road sitting out there with a school, not that infrastructure not there. I mean, I think there's a whole lot of things that go before the other one.
If I could add in there, it's a good question. I can tell you that it will not decrease. Traffic will not decrease, which means the likelihood of access will not decrease in the next 5 years. I believe it will certainly increase. It certainly will not decrease. If we leave it alone, we have increased traffic flow from whatever building or development occurs out there.
Is there a way for events, though, to, like, close off one of the that exit and send people out as a ride only off ZZ?
Yes, certainly, yeah. We take staffing to do that, either staff on the school district's part or on the city's part. I'm not certain that DZ is any better, except that the difference with DZ side is that it's wider.
Right, right.
So, which is the issue that we're kind of looking at on the M side.
And there's no hill.
Yeah, I mean, it could be done. Yes, the answer to your question is, yeah, we could direct out vehicles onto the DZ side and avoid that, but it would take additional staffing, and that's cost to us, whether it's ours or school.
Of course, you could do that for events if you have 1,400 kids leaving.
Right.
Now, James River Church in Ozark did something similar to that until they built a new separate access to the highway, which did solve the need to have city police there and volunteers to direct traffic. So.
Well, but that stadium isn't going to increase enrollment, you know.
The stadium is that's an election issue, too.
Right, right, right. Yeah, it's a what-if. Yeah, it's a what-if.
Mr. Wilson.
One thing to consider, the school buses, they come in and they go out on M Highway, and at times they're back way up trying to get out on the M Highway. So there's something that needs to be done there before one of them gets hit in the middle.
And Mr. Mayor, in relationship to the route we address school buses as to the turning radius, because that was one of the questions we had even in the meeting. We asked everything that I could think of is to address, well, how are they going to be able to make that turn? Can they make that turn? So revisions are made into the design and all that for bus traffic. But that was the other, I forgot just to talk with in the discussion was the stack-up line trying to get out of the school.
Yeah. But the way it is now, they have a problem getting out at times.
Mayor, if I could add one comment, please.
You may.
In the mitigation plan that was approved by FEMA, seen a year ago, the traffic management around the high school was listed in the mitigation plan as a priority for not only the city, but also the school district, which would allow some of this granting money to occur. So it's been identified as a serious issue.
Thank you, Lynn. Any other questions for Mr. Brock? Any concerns? All good questions, all good comments. Nobody? All right. All in favor? Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. Resolution number 16-R-86. Resolution of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, authorizing the execution of a professional engineering consulting services agreement with Olson Associates for the design of drainage improvements to West Logan Street. I need a motion and a second.
Motion.
Second.
And Mr. Brock.
Thank you, Mayor. This resolution would kick off the beginning of a neighborhood stormwater improvement project. This is located on the northwest side of town, West Logan Avenue. We have a drainage basin that probably best described as uncontrolled. Runs over the top of Logan Avenue. We've seen some real degradation of the pavement over there through a number of front yards and backyards. It is a floodplain that's had development through it a number of years ago. This particular area was selected by the Capital Improvements Committee. I think we had four other potential neighborhood projects that were competing against this one, and the committee selected this as being the highest priority. We do have money budgeted for 2016 for both engineering and land easement acquisition. We've negotiated a scope of services and contract with Olson Engineering. Nathan Meyer is with us tonight with Olson. Nathan has been a stormwater engineer on a number of previous projects. Very pleased with Nathan's work. I think he will serve as project manager on this particular project, so maybe a promotion for Mr. Meyer. The scope of work is listed here on as an attachment to the agreement. This will get us through plan design, bidding, and construction. I do want to mention the scope of work also includes some administrative and hydraulic and design work about 400 or 500 feet east of this location. There's an existing box culvert under Hine Street that, man, I'm going to say it was built in the 1930s. They did good work back there, but it doesn't last forever. We've seen some structural problems, and so Olson will do some design work, get us through floodplain issues. Also within this not to exceed $48,000 amount.
This is a unique area out in the, thank you, David. This is a unique area out there at on Logan Street. I would suggest council go and look at that because, Gary, do you have anything down on that with capital improvements? We drove out there and on high rain, that road just completely floods and it blocks off that exit to those, what, two or three houses back there?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, do get a chance, council, go out and look at that area. It's kind of a unique area. Any questions for Mr. Brock?
Mayor?
Yes, sir.
Just one point of clarification that we're going to do as we move forward. It's noted on the second page where the, by statute, there are certain insurance liabilities that are required. They've been reduced from $2,734,2 million. I just want to make note of that because there are provisions in the statute that do allow that. And I think that in the future, one of the things that I've mentioned is that we bring that note and bring that attention to the council's attention just so that when liability insurance is being reduced from what statute is required, that you're aware of it before your approval or as part of that in this project. And so there are times when we've checked with the insurance company. So for me to be completely clear on it, we had to call our own insurance company, but I want these things included in the approval process so that you're aware when you're approving it that you are, that the provision to waive some of that liability is understood on the front end for the engineer that's involved on the project.
Does that affect the bottom line?
It does not affect the bottom line, but there are state statute provisions that are being waived that are written in statute that we have. There was a previous policy from years ago that allowed for city staff to go through a checklist of items that would allow to reduce liability. And it concerns me when those things are reduced and you're not aware of it on the front end, because I'm not an engineer and I don't know whether or not the liability of that. So for the administrator to sign off on that provision is concerning when I wouldn't know whether that's a safe bet or not. So I look for us to change or amend that language in the policy that it's required as part of the bid specification of the contract or something different than just...
So basically, the engineering firm is the one that's reducing their liability.
Yeah, we're
asking them for less, proof of less
than what's required by state statute.
Right.
And there is a resolution or provision on the books that provided it to the administrator 2 or 3 years ago. They go through a checklist that the public works director, the finance director, or whoever's in charge of the finance director and administrator sign off on it. Well, I would venture to tell you, like I indicated, neither John nor myself would know in that situation whether waiving of liability, reducing it, is in order, so you have to defer to the department head to do that. I just think that the council should be aware anytime you're reducing it, it ought to be part of the resolution and the adoption.
How long has Olson been in business? Any?
60 years.
60? So I would assume that they probably have an umbrella policy.
They do.
So the internal limits on most commercials can be wrote at $2 million per occurrence and $4 million aggregate. And if they have an internal limit of $2 million plus an umbrella of $1 million, that would be a combined of over the 2.7.
Yeah, we should have called him instead of our insurance company. That's basically what they told us. So
yeah, I mean, if you've got an umbrella,
they carry an umbrella of $9 million.
Of $9 million?
Yes.
So that would be in excess of over and above if we exhaust the two.
When the process that Mr. Cameron mentioned is a risk management tool when you go any kind of project. Our official policy is pretty straightforward. The amount of insurance is based on a dollar amount. tiered dollar amount, and I think it's $25,000 or above, then you require the full statutory limit. But if you look at it from just risk management, you consider what is it are they doing. You may have a very small project where you're cutting down a tree, but the circumstances are you want the full $2.7 million insurance. You could have a large project where there's not a lot of exposure, and that's typically what we see with these engineering projects. The biggest exposure will be when their survey crews are out here for a day or day and a half, and they've got commercial vehicles and they're working out in the open. Other than that, it's pretty much office work or in our offices. So we're just trying to be frugal and apply the insurance limits where they're best needed and not have to ask for any or incur any additional cost with those higher limits.
How much do we save? How much do we save by lowering that?
I do not know. There was some issue when we were discussing whether that umbrella policy was going to be sufficient or not. I don't know if maybe Olson went back and looked at.
I don't know that we have a person.
I do know we've had some construction contracts where insurance was had to go out and buy that specifically, and they turned in the invoice for that as a justification for a change order, and that was about $2,800 to get the city as a named insured with the full statutory limitation on it. Now, whether that's the same for every professional firm or contractor, I don't know, but I do know in that instance we were able to see what that dollar amount cost that contractor.
So we're agreeing, though, that we say yes, that we will not go after their umbrella.
No, not at all.
No?
I'll have to leave it to...
My understanding is the discussion we were having was with a construction contract where they submitted less than the statutory amount, but they had a $5 million umbrella.
They've got it. We're just asking for proof of...
Yeah.
Less.
Yeah.
So it's still there.
Yeah. And the question I don't know the answer to, you probably do, is if you buy $2 million worth of coverage and you have a $3 million umbrella, have they saved any money by buying $2 million with a $3 million umbrella?
Usually if your internal limits are higher, your umbrella is less. Because your exposure to the umbrella, it's going to take a lot more to get to that umbrella.
Yeah. But does that make a big difference in what the insured is having to pay?
It can, but it's not like, it depends on the scope of work, the amount of work, like as far as it could go off of payroll, it could go off of man hours, it could go off of yearly, annual fees. So it just all depends on what they're being rated on.
Okay.
Tell me a little bit about your selection process. We're agreeing to pay $48,000. How do we know that's a good rate, or how we know that's competitive?
The last page in Exhibit B is what we call a task matrix, where we require the consultant to go through and they actually identify the different individuals that will be working on the project. I don't want to say we haggle, but you go through and well, how much time do you have here? And well, if we take this approach, can reduce that down? We're pretty familiar with Olson. We know what their hourly rates are. So it's really more of an issue of making sure that they're being efficient with their time.
Let me rephrase that. Did we go look at other firms to make sure that we got the best pricing?
We did not. On these type of projects, we typically want the best engineer. Pricing certainly is a matter, but having individuals and firms that we think will fit our staff, our community, our neighborhood, I guess I put a little higher value on that than just a strict dollar.
Sure. I mean, I think there's many pieces to it, but just making sure that we're looking and not...
It's a fiduciary responsibility.
Right. I will say that the professional engineers have good lobbyists. There are statutes that prohibit selecting engineer on the basis of price. So
okay.
I did my duty for the professional engineers of the state.
Yes, but routinely you do put out statements of qualifications and do selections is also as part of that same process that while it does not involve price, you can select other engineering firms to do the exact same work. And so I would say that I do think that this has nothing to do with Olson. I would look at it just like I would an auditing firm. When you do utilize the same firm over and over again, I do think it is fiduciary responsible.
That's exactly where I'm going
to change.
About the money.
It's not just about the money. I do believe there are times that you should utilize different firms. And so it's just like we're going to be doing with our audit this year. We're going to be using a different auditor to do our work. And I think that that's proven that that's going to be a smart decision. I'm not saying anything against Olson's work, but what I'm saying is I think that if you're using the same one for 21 years or 20 years, that's good historical knowledge. But you cannot go off price, but you can certainly do statements of qualifications, and there are other people that are qualified to do the same design. And so, but you cannot even, but it could be $10,000 higher, so you cannot say, hey, we want to go back to the other engineering firm. So.
Thank you.
Mr. Jones.
How old is this existing box culvert? How old is the development?
Well, we're in two different physical locations. The Logan Street drainage is the very west end, dead end of Logan Street. That was built in the 70s. There's a cul-de-sac on the end that was built in late 1990s, early 2000. Meadowview, is that the name of the subdivision? I'm not sure. The other culvert is about 800 feet away. It's east of West Avenue. And we think that was built in the 1930s, 1940s.
Is the current circumstances, is it because of a failure in one of those culverts, or is it just it's over the past now?
Well, the neighborhood that we want to work through, when they built streets in 1970, just letting that water flow over the top of the street was acceptable. There was development in the 70s in that area where they built up the floodplain, and that's caused some issues where what was once a broad channel now has kind of been narrowed down. The other location, the culvert under Hine Street, that's just really just age. Worn out and nearing the end of its lifespan.
Need a little more clarification on that, Mr. Jones?
No.
David, and this is not, in light of our budget discussion as we go forward, and in fairness, I'm not asking this question, so this is, I don't like to do it this way, but could our crews build this to offset the operating costs with the equipment that we have, with some of the discussion of having to transfer operating cash from street to stormwater, maybe not having enough stuff to do? Is this something that can be built in-house with our crews?
Absolutely.
Then I think that that's something that, based upon our discussion, that while it's being engineered, I think that consideration could be utilizing our street crews to help offset some of the losses in the street fund. Could be a consideration. It's about a $470,000 project, so it could help offset the losses of what street staff may not be able to work on and deal with stormwater. So I just want to make that. Thank you for that answer.
Thanks for that input.
Yes.
Any other questions for Mr. Brock on this particular resolution? Again, good discussion. Appreciate the questions. No questions, no other comments. We all got our questions answered. Okay, seeing none, all in favor, say aye.
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 All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries 7-0.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm going to be seated and I'll not be returning.
You'll not? You did a good job. Thank you, David. Resolution number 16-R-87, a resolution of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, concerning the change of council meeting dates, time, and approval of the 2017 City Council and other meeting dates.
Do we need
a motion and a second.
Motion. Second.
I have a motion and a second. Mr. Cameron.
Do we need to make a correction to...
I would make that note. If the council wants to amend that to reflect Tuesday instead of Monday, that would be...
I'll make a motion.
Service group.
I'll make a motion to change Monday to Tuesday on this document.
Be changing to the first Tuesday instead of...
It'll be the first and third Tuesdays of each month versus the document currently says Monday, first and third Mondays.
Ron's getting his ink pen going.
All we're talking about is in the whereas, right?
Is that correct, in the whereas?
And in the discussion or analysis.
That yeah, it'd be in the whereas, be the third whereas, it would read, if the amendment is presented with one motion, though, is Tuesday.
It's changing Monday to Tuesday in the third whereas.
We need a second.
We need a second.
Let me ask, okay, 5:30 and 6:30, are we changing the time to 6:30, or is that still, I mean... Or are we going to leave it at 7, or was there going to be a discussion on that?
It's in there at 6:30.
Okay. Just want everybody to be aware of that. So the only change right now is to the Monday on the third whereas.
To a Tuesday.
To a Tuesday.
Okay, yeah. That...
Would you, Mr. Mendez, would you please make that motion again so we...
I'll make a motion to change the first and third Monday to the first and third Tuesday under the second whereas.
Third whereas.
Third whereas.
I have a second on that.
Second.
We have a second. You have a motion and a second.
Third.
We do it all in favor of the discussion.
Just all in favor.
All in favor for that amendment. Say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? And the motion to amend carries 7-0. Now on to the discussion. Mr. Cannon.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Again, I appreciate the opportunity and the work session to discuss kind of the why behind this discussion. One of them is, first and foremost, is to create an additional day for reviewing of the board packet, council packet. It's going to go out on the same day. It provides an additional day to review. It also allows for us to discuss that we'll be having a work session. We don't have to have a work session, but there'll be more routinely. There'll be work sessions at 5:30, 1 hour prior to the council meeting that would discuss either something that is an agenda item. It's not to not involve the community. It's just something to discuss, like I said, a land purchase or something of that nature before it gets on the agenda. It'd be a great discussion about what to do, like talking about the grant funds and things about that as we proceed. And so part of the discussion is to do that. Then a lot of it is to alter the schedule that would make it more conducive to different events that go on with the Missouri Municipal League where we could attend the annual conference and things of that nature. But what's outlined there, I like the idea of engaging council more often in discussions regarding the subject matter, but changing it, netting that an additional day to review the packet, to me, offers the opportunity for more questions and just less confusion moving forward. So I request your consideration for the changes for this one and the next resolution.
Any questions for Mr. Cameron?
I do have a question. Will this change have, do we need to account for the planning and zoning in any way as to when your meeting will be? Will it need to be changed, or will it stay the same?
It'll have to be changed. The council's moved to
first and third.
P&Z will need to be either second or fourth.
But this is on Tuesday night, so they could still meet on Monday night.
The only question I would have is whether there's an ordinance requirement for 7 days between.
Yeah, there is. So with the proposal, this whole meeting matrix is going to have to be reworked. I also noticed that the Board of Adjustment is penciled in at meeting times. Is that going to be an issue that shouldn't conflict?
That would only be if there is that 7-day requirement, which I don't recall. call.
And some things there may be, I'd have to look at that.
There is that requirement, and I don't object to being on Tuesdays, I'd be happy to.
I'm just trying to figure out when we would need to have your meeting in relation to the second meeting, because right now we have a week's lapse between planning and zoning meeting and the second meeting, so that would move you up to between the first and the third. You'd need to have your planning and zoning meeting on the second Monday.
Yep.
In between. Yeah, okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, sir.
Is that established by resolution, or is that established by, or is that something that could be just a policy change, or is that something that's got to be established?
It's established by this.
Yeah.
It's on this schedule here.
Okay.
It'd just be a matter of changing this to be consistent with what he needs to do.
So do we need an amendment to that, or is it just a point of order to clarify the schedule needs to be amended?
Purpose these meeting dates on the green cap. Attached as the. I think with the. Plans the second Monday. Okay, so you already. You've done. Okay.
I was going to say, I already
Brenda,
thought.
Brenda's already done it.
Yeah, I was
going to
say, I thought that was already addressed somewhere
okay.
in the. You let the whole discussion.
Yeah.
Nicely.
Yeah.
Go,
I could have jumped in a little sooner.
She was waiting to point at
this.
City Clerk of the Year. Okay, so we're
good.
Okay. Now, any questions for Mr. Cameron or Mr. Derrickson that Brenda can answer?
Yeah.
I would defer all to Brenda.
Any questions, any comments, any discussion on this? I know we talked about it a little bit before, and we came up with a solution. Mr. Jones came up with a good solution for about calling me. Make sure you're texting me.
Oh, yeah.
So, any other questions for Mr. Cameron on this? Particular resolution? Anything? Okay.
When did it take effect?
Will that take effect January?
January 3rd will be
the first council meeting.
30.
Okay. No other questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries 7-0. Resolution number 16-R-88. A resolution of the City Council of the City of Republic, Missouri, amending Resolution Number 07-R-12 regarding establishing rules and order of business. I need a motion and a second.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Mr. Cameron again.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Again, just another opportunity to change just a little bit. Opportunity for the council discussion. You'll note in the agenda on the second page, it notes reports from staff, so the staff reports myself and Mr. Keeling. Any financial will be moved to the back. There's also number 15 offers council reports, and so at that stage, it would provide the opportunity at the end of it before we adjourn, make the motion to adjourn, to go around the table, allow each member of council to offer anything that's going on or anything that you'd like to see, or any comment or any report that you'd like to see, or ask an update, that stuff could be taken care of. Or if there's some pressing issue that was not on the agenda, issues of that nature, and I just like to kind of provide a little more feedback for staff the following day, and so I'd just like to add that to the moving forward, just for more discussion, more dialogue as we move forward, and especially if we're talking about the future of the city direction. So, again, I request your consideration for approval on this. Appreciate it.
Any questions for Mr. Cameron? I do on the agenda on this. What's the changing of the word in there? Pledge of allegiance to the United
States. The way the resolution reads now is it says salute to the United States flag, and we're changing it to pledge of allegiance to the United States flag to be consistent with what we're actually doing.
Oh, okay.
And then I do need to clarify one thing. You
want the financial also moved to staff reports?
Yes, please.
Okay. We need to do an amendment then to move financial, remove financial from paragraph 8. And I don't even know, do we need board commission and committee reports? I don't recall ever having one, but that's always been in there. Or do you just want to put all that under the umbrella of reports from staff? Just basically take number 8 and move it to be with
reports of staff.
Number 14?
I would.
Okay. If we could have
I'll make a motion to remove financial.
Oh, just from all of 8
remove
be
all
incorporated
of 8.
Into. What is called number 14 report.
Could 9
staff.
Not be the same thing since that's coming from, I'm sorry, it just seems like that'd be the same report from staff for future community events.
Yeah, we could do it. Yeah.
That's your pleasure.
It makes sense to me. You guys, okay. So I'll make a motion to remove number 8 or include all of the financial board commissions and community reports underneath, including number 9, future community events underneath 14 reports from staff.
And to renumber appropriately.
And to renumber appropriately.
Well, I got a wordy motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second on the motion. All in favor for the motion?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion for the amendment carries. Now discussion. Any questions for Mr. Cameron on the changes being made, the proposed changes being made to our amendment? Agenda.
Everybody's getting tired.
5:30 we started?
No questions, no comments, no discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? And motion carries. Before we adjourn or ask a motion for adjournment, I'd like to wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving. Everybody enjoy the Thanksgiving holiday. Don't eat too much turkey or eat too much turkey, whatever you'd like to do. Don't forget, we do have a show at the amphitheater this weekend on Friday night.
Indoor community center.
Move to the community center. Indoor the community center. And the Christmas parade Saturday. I will accept a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Second.
I have a motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Happy Thanksgiving.
Figured it out. We all said I'd have